HarperCollins presents Restoring the Wild, 60 Years of Rewilding Our Skies, Woods and Waterways by Roy Dennis, read by Roger Davis. Introduction. I've been interested in helping wildlife since I was a young boy in the early 1950s. Then it was a matter of rearing young birds and animals that I found abandoned, even though some of them may not actually have needed my help. Jackdaws were a favourite of mine, and I have happy memories of rearing three shell ducklings which I found wandering along the road in coastal Hampshire. What a thrill it was to see them fly after me, a squadron of outriders, as I rode my bike. Little did I know then that this calling would form the basis of my life's work. It has always been my view that our aim as nature conservationists should be to make rare species more common and more secure for the future. My mind was always on ecological restoration, now more often called rewilding. In an era of appalling declines in nature, leading to lost or isolated populations, mainly due to human activity, I believe that species translocations and reintroductions must become standard wildlife management. This audiobook is about the many species restoration or rewilding projects that I have been involved with in my life so far. It covers recovery projects, such as Goldeneye, translocations, such as Red Squirrel, and reintroductions, such as Sea Eagle, a complex mix. I wanted to write a book about these exciting projects, making certain that I explained the failures as well as the successes, with an emphasis on the early stages. Specific dates, of course, are certain. The young sea eagles arrived at Fair Isle on the 28th of June 1968. The first red kites from Sweden came to the Scottish Highlands on an RAF Nimrod on the 20th of June 1989. But much of the story is, as so often, a record preserved in the notebooks, diaries, letters, and memories of the writer, and may differ from other people's accounts. I found it fascinating to go back and read my writings and view my photos, stretching back to my childhood, often long forgotten. There are several levels of memory. My writings, especially my diaries and notebooks, give me the exact dates, places, and what we were doing. But it's when I look at the photographs taken at the time that the colours, textures, scents, and sounds flood back. Some events I can no longer properly remember, but I do know that I was at the Scottish Ornithologists Club's Northern Counties Conference in Inverness in November 1962, when I was 22. The speakers were prominent ornithologists of the time, George Dunnett and Harry Milne of Aberdeen University, Derek Mills, Ian Penny, and Joe Egling. A report of the conference in the journal Scottish Birds notes, Roy concluded the morning's session with an entertaining talk on the encouragement of rare breeding species, in which he put forward some excellent ideas for attracting these visitors on a wider scale. I cannot find a record of that talk, but did find some scribblings in which I worked out that a pair of reintroduced sea eagles could be worth £15,000 a year in tourism revenues to Northern Sutherland. Times change and years go by, and now the sea eagles are worth £5 million a year to the Isle of Mull alone. It's hard to believe now that when I started birding, books on birds and mammals were relatively scarce, and new titles were eagerly awaited. What we did have was a marvellous series of Victorian-era books on birds and mammals, especially the county or regional faunas, written at the start of the 20th century by J. A. Harvey Brown and his contemporaries. On dark nights or rainy days, I remember the thrill of reading the likes of The Vertebrate Fauna of the Northwest Highlands and Sky to find vivid details of sea eagles, nowadays called white-tailed eagles, swirling above their breeding sites. I would read about places which in the 1960s lacked that iconic tag of wildness, or tales of wolves and bears in James Ritchie's book The Influence of Man on Animal Life in Scotland, published in 1920. Who could forget the image of the people of Idrakillis in Sutherland taking their dead to the island of Handa for burial to save the bodies from being dug up by wolves, known locally as the Prowlers of the Night? My most lasting memories from those old books tend to be of the incredible onslaught by man on the larger birds and mammals of the Scottish Highlands and Islands. Savage descriptions of killing the last wolf in Scotland, Mr. McQueen, who lived near to Martin, dispatching it with his dirk or hunting knife in a side stream of the River Findhorn, which I can now see in the distance when I drive south from my home, or the incredible numbers of birds of prey and predatory mammals shot, trapped and poisoned by the gamekeepers creating the sporting estates for the hunting of red deer and red grouse and the fishing of salmon. On the notorious Glengarry estates near Fort Augustus, many thousands were killed. But this drive to remove competitors to the human interests of sheep farming or game sports was widespread. Some species, like the beaver, had gone much earlier, not because they were pests, but because they were too valuable for their own good, their fur, medicinal oil or meat, much sought after. My generation was fortunate to be born into better times, with nature conservation starting to take a lead, and the obvious question to some of us was how we could get these species back. Most of these iconic creatures had died out, not through changing climate or loss of available food or habitat. Nearly all were cases of simple but appalling extermination by man. And so we talked about this when we met, gossiping over a beer at a winter conference or while eating our piece on a mountain ridge. There was an exciting opportunity to redress the damage of previous generations, if we could only grasp it. What a thrilling prospect that was. But then, when young, I never foresaw how difficult it would be, and how many social and political hurdles would be thrown in our way, even by our colleagues and friends. With this audiobook, I've tried to show how some of these projects came about, the excitements, the obstacles, the failures, and the successes. I've often concentrated on the early stages of projects, especially those that went on to be very successful, for those were the times when we just had to get our heads down, determined to get the job done with the help of really good friends. These projects are always teamwork. I hope my contemporaries enjoy listening to the accounts of different species, and I also hope that anyone interested in nature finds the stories fascinating and, in general, encouraging in difficult times. As always, I urge young people in school, in work, at university, or freshly graduated to take note that wildlife recovery projects are very long-term and need determination and perseverance. Often the social and political difficulties of starting the translocation of a species far outweigh the ecological and technical aspects. So, most importantly, anyone wishing to carry out projects must remember that a determined and positive mind is called for. It's a matter of when, not if. In 1995, I was invited by Professor Wolf Schroeder and Christoph Bromberger, large mammal specialists at Munich University, to join them on a summer expedition to the Upper Porcupine River in Canada to study bears and wolves. In Whitehorse, we met one of their friends at the Wildlife Division. "Roy has a dream of restoring wolves to the Scottish Highlands," said Christoph. His response, "Do you work with any other species?" I told him about my projects on ospreys, eagles, and red kites. "That's good," he replied, "because if you work with only one species, you will come to a roadblock from a person in authority, maybe even a senior colleague, and then you will have to put your project on the back burner. One day he or she will be promoted, will retire or die, and that may take years. When it happens, you must immediately push forward, so it's important to have a variety of projects moving at different speeds. It turned out to be very pertinent advice. Looking back now, I realize that great things have happened, but I'm disappointed. I'm disappointed that we have not had more success, especially with large mammals. The return of the red kite has been incredible, but this was because of a determined program of rolling releases from north and south, and the strength of the long-term project team members from the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds, Nature Conservancy and its subsequent national agencies, and enthusiastic individuals and groups. Compare this to the failure so far to get the sea eagle breeding again in England and Wales, and the incredible opposition by farmers, politicians, and even some conservationists to the return of the lynx. Yet remember, there's always change. I think now that if we had really worked hard, we could have restored beaver, lynx, crane, and eagle owl to Scotland in the 1960s and 70s. There would have been opposition from some of our colleagues, because in their view that would not have been natural. But in those days there was much less organised opposition from vested interests. A few really enthusiastic people, with large landholdings and sufficient funds, could have forged new and exciting ecological pathways. I guess our horizons and hopes were not broad enough. Since that time, the idea of the reintroduction of charismatic species has become more formalised, more difficult, and attracted greater opposition, not just from parts of the landowning, farming, forestry, and fisheries communities who see their own interests threatened, but also from individuals and bodies within nature conservation. Guidelines which were intended to help became ever more restrictive and bureaucratic. One needs to learn, often by painful processes, that the early stages of a bold idea will attract the attention of doubters and opponents to change, as well as supporters. Once a project gets started, there is a shift and opposition lessens, and finally, when it is successful, the early naysayers claim ownership. But that matters little to you if your principal aim is to restore nature. Some of the projects described in this audiobook have been written up in the scientific literature, often by others, but that will always have a limited readership. I have always been happy to give radio and television interviews at any time, and ready to help journalists and photographers to write good stories. That can have real impact, but often leaves little permanent record. Our projects, often featured in my illustrated lectures and talks to RSPB member groups and bird clubs, as well as to audiences in the wider community. I enjoyed doing these lectures, seeing the wide variation in numbers and interests, ranging from the evening with just one person, when the school janitor in the Uists forgot to put up the posters, to an audience of more than 2,000 scientists at a major conference in Glasgow. This contact with the public at home and abroad often had a beneficial impact, and I particularly like to encourage the young to push for change, bypassing the strictures of their seniors. Finally, it's essential to realise that in the same half century, the impacts of modern agriculture, forestry, industry, chemical pollution, and humanity on the natural world have become ever more destructive. We have now reached another era when the prospect of climate breakdown and biodiversity loss threatens life on Earth. This is especially pertinent to our young people. So, alongside major ecological restoration and rewilding, there is much greater interest in and support for large-scale restoration and recovery of our native fauna and flora. It's time to get on with the task and listen to the concerns of the young. So, let's look at the projects and species in detail. to help them shape a better future. Chapter 1. Serendipity. The Return of the Majestic Sea Eagle. So much in life depends on good luck, on being in the right...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.